Equal Pay Day.
Very nice to enter the stage to ABBA, of course. I did not know about the red theme, so I'm sorry about that. I'll be better next year. It's really a great honor for me to be invited to address you, such a distinguished audience here, and to be the first speaker today on this important day, focusing on women and gender equality at work. As was recently pointed out, I'm the Swedish ambassador to the Czech Republic. I've been here for 7 months. Before coming to the Czech Republic, I was the consul general in Shanghai. I have been a career diplomat with the Swedish Ministry for Foreign Affairs for about 20 years. I am married and I have two children, and we are 16 and 11. And my family has been traveling with me around the world for all the time. When I entered the Foreign Service 20 years ago, I entered a quite male-dominated career. But today, I work for a feminist government which is pursuing a feminist foreign policy. So there are lots of changes that have taken place. And I would like to use this opportunity to tell you a little bit about this journey and also say a couple of words about what a feminist foreign policy is actually all about. As I said, when I entered the foreign ministry in 1996, only 10% of our ambassadors were women. Today in the Swedish foreign ministry, there are 40% of our ambassadors who are women. The quite substantial pay gap that existed in the ministry in 1996 has almost disappeared. These are, of course, only numbers, but they show you a little bit of the journey, and I'd like to try to say something about what's behind this change. There are, of course, many factors behind a pay gap between women and men. We have heard that here in Czech Republic it's 22%. In Sweden it is 13%. Although there are many factors, I think that one of the greatest challenges to equality at work is the inequality at home and the very big difficulty of combining a career with a family. When you start your university and during the first years of your career, often the gender issue is not so pronounced. But once you get children, the divide starts, and it's often to the economic disadvantage of women. If your workplace is also very traditionally and male-dominated, this strain might be even worse, as there might be very little understanding for your situation. I think everyone who is a working parent would have experienced that stress you can feel when the very square rules of your working life crashes in to the unpredictable life as a parent, and I think this happens to both men and women. I'm quite sure we've all seen it in different Hollywood film productions, and I'm sure most of you have also experienced it, how you stand there, maybe you are just going to the minister to present a policy proposal, when the kindergarten calls you and tells you your child is ill and you immediately have to come and pick him up. Of course, you anyway do your presentation, because you have to, and then you lose a little bit of the concentration, and then you rush away to the kindergarten, and the teachers are angry, and the child is crying, and once you are coming home, you feel that your situation is a little bit unsustainable, your boss is not happy, kindergarten is not happy, child is not happy, and you are also feeling very stressed. This is a kind of common situation for a lot of women at work. And this difficulty of getting your life together is often the main reason behind so many women giving up on their careers, reducing their ambition, and many women take part-time jobs or jobs for which maybe they are overqualified. Of course, it leads to lower wages, and when we get older, it leads to lower pensions. It also puts a lot of women in a disadvantaged situation when we want to negotiate for salaries and compete for higher positions. I think to balance your career and your private life is also often made much harder than it has to be because of inflexible structures, discriminating policies, and prejudgments of all sorts. When I myself was a young mother at the ministry, I often felt very shy to negotiate harder for better pay because I felt a little bit guilty for not staying overtime, not staying in the evenings. Even if not much was happening, a lot of the others were. I also felt a little bit bad for sometimes having to stay home with a sick child. I felt very much it was my duty to adapt to the habits of the workplace, and I would never have assumed that it should have been my employer who should have had the responsibility to adapt a little bit to my needs in any way. I served in the Balkans straight after the war, and later I served in the African department, and I did quite a lot of trips to conflict zones like Darfur, Mali, and Liberia. And to be a woman diplomat in these kind of tough, male-dominated conflict places, that was not a big issue. It was not a difficulty. What remained difficult was to combine the wish to advance my career with the fact that I was also a parent. Although I give full credit to my husband, who often did more than his share taking care of our family. In the ministry then, although an equal amount of women and men had for a long time entered the service, it remained so that women did not advance. There's a lot of women in the lower position, but when you came up to the ambassadorial level, there were almost no women to be found, and the pay gap remained. Then things started to change. The government, which was 50% women in Sweden, found the situation unsustainable and unacceptable, and they demanded of the Foreign Service that something would have to be done. The ministry started to work actively for a more gender-balanced situation. As we were getting more women into leading positions, younger women at the ministry got new role models at work. I think when you're a young woman at the workplace, it's quite good if you have some female bosses that you can look up to and that you can use as your mentors. More women bosses in the service also led to an alteration of working habits and styles. If you have a young foreign minister with children, she does not plan a staff meeting at 4:30 in the afternoon, because she knows the tight time frame for a young family, and she will make sure that important work meetings are carried out during scheduled work hours. Flexible work hours, better technology to facilitate work from home, paid kindergarten when you were serving abroad, and a strong push for gender sensitizing all routines and all procedures at the ministry were other changes which were gradually introduced. The work still remains demanding, but there is a new flexibility and there is a new understanding. And this has led to that much more women dare to take on leading positions. As the women advanced, their salaries were of course also increasing and the pay gap started closing. And as I said in the beginning today, we have 40% of our ambassadors placed abroad being career diplomats who have followed a career and reached to the top. I think it's still very tough to combine family life with a diplomatic career. But if you take on the challenge, it's good to know that your employer is going to sustain you and work with you, not work against you. Another part that is important to underline is that once a workplace, whether it's a ministry or a company, when they start to become gender sensitive, it does not start discriminating the men. On the contrary, it opens up to all of its staff and it asks, what do you need? in order to do your work the best way. How do you get your life together, your private life and your working life? And what can be done to adjust working condition and working hours in career planning for you? When you ask new questions, you also get new perspectives. And for us, this has benefited both men and women at the ministry. And it has also benefited the ministry as a working place. Now I'd like to say something about a feminist foreign policy and what it means. I have heard here in the Czech Republic that the word feminist is sometimes controversial and that it provokes negative reactions. But to us, I must say, it's a word of strength. And for the Swedish government, what it means is that women and men shall enjoy the same opportunities, rights, and obligations in all areas of life. Everyone should have the same possibility and the same power to shape their future. In the same way as this microcosmos of the ministry that I have been describing, a gender-based perspective is now placed on all areas of society in Sweden. And it really means all areas. And what it does is that it provokes new questions and seeks new answers for how to advance. The same goes for our foreign policy. To achieve a peaceful world which develops in a sustainable way, it demands the active participation of women on equal terms. Unfortunately, in many places in the world, I would say most places, this is still not the case. The issue is an issue of rights, representation, and resources. And that is also what's set key in our policy. Women's economic power is absolutely an important element in a feminist foreign policy, and of course also for the whole development agenda for this world. And the ongoing struggle for equal pay is a crucial bit on the path towards a fairer and more gender equal world. To conclude a little bit, I want to summarize my observation and underline that the question of equal pay is much more complex than just increasing your wage or negotiating wealth. It's really the top of an iceberg. And under the surface, there is this mountain of structures which must be altered in order to change the situation. And probably this is the reason why we have still not reached further than we have, although the fight for equal pay has been going on for such a long time. Working life cannot be separated from family life. And while we have to try to create a more equal situation at home, with our partners, in our families, policymakers and employees also have to create a more flexible and dynamic situation which much better allows for family and career to coexist for both men and women. A bit of flexibility, reliable childcare, and better understanding actually goes a long way. And if this equation is not solved, women are likely to continue to lose out economically. Finally, a feminist perspective is not at all an anti-man perspective. A gender-equal world is not a zero-sum game, but it's a win-win situation for everyone. A feminist perspective is an inclusive perspective which states the obvious, that we all have the equal right to pursue our dreams, whatever they may be. Thank you very much for having me.